We shall go on to our next speaker now. Our next speaker is Dr. Gopinathan, who is a consultant cataract and cornea and refractive surgeries at the Tirupur branch of the Eye Foundation Group of Hospitals. He has prolific skills and a potential to drive really forward, and he has a relevant tip for us. So on to you, Dr. Gopinath. Mr. Sunil, can you share his video?
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for the nice words. Am I audible, ma'am?
Yes.
Good afternoon, all. I would like to thank Dr. Sia Madam and ARC panel for giving me this opportunity. IT team, can I have the, thank you. First slide, please. Today, I would like to discuss with you a case of the previous slide. Today, I would like to discuss with you a case of traumatic cataract with zonal dehiscence. Our patient was a 60-year-old male with a history of injury to the left eye with a ball while playing 4 months back. On examination, he had a right eye early cataract and left eye traumatic cataract with a no zonular support from 3 to 7 o'clock position, with only a small frond of vitreous coming from the zonular dehiscence. Both eyes' retinas were normal, so we planned to go ahead with the left eye phaco with 3-piece IOL plus anterior vitrectomy with the CTR under Gardner-Bishop prognosis. Pre-op diffraction was improving only to 660. Next slide, please. For this case of left eye surgery, I was sitting temporarily, and this is the case video. As we can see, the zonular dehiscence is extending 3 to 4 clock hours from 3 to 7 o'clock position, with only a small frond of vitreous trying to come out from the zonular dehiscence area. So initially, I didn't go ahead with any anterior vitrectomy. I made a rexus of 4.5 to 5 millimeter deliberately so that it could accommodate sulcus placement of IOL with optic capture if needed later during the course of the surgery. Yeah, gentle and cortical flaring hydrodissection was done. Then two side ports were made along the area of zonular dehiscence to accommodate two capsular hooks so as to secure the bag in position and prevent further vitreous loss during manipulation. A small but gentle rotation of the nucleus was made to assess both the back support and free rotation of the cataract before starting phacoemulsification. Since any adhesion would, due to incomplete cortical flaping, would create a lot of stress on the zonules while doing phaco. Then I straight away went with the phacoemulsification without putting any CTR for three main reasons. One, it was only a localized zonal dehiscence with adequate surrounding support. And second was, it was only a grade 1 to 2 cataract, which would be easily removed without much stress on the zonules. And third and important reason being is that if the CTR is placed during early course of the surgery, it could cause a lot of hindrance to do a thorough cortical cleanup at the end of the case, which would cause a lot of stress on the zonules and increase the dehiscence. So a gentle phaco was done, making sure not to cause further zonular weakness or vitreous prolapse. Then a 3-piece sensor IOL was placed in the bag, and it was dialed into position such that one of its haptic is supporting the area of dehiscence. Injection trimestone was then injected into the anterior chamber to strain for vitreous. As expected, there were a lot of vitreous strands coming out from the side port and the main port. A complete but careful anterior vitrectomy was done without injuring the rexus margin or the iris. Finally, a CTR of size 13 was put in the bag through one of the side ports to make sure the bag is held in position and dehiscence area is adequately supported. After placing the CTR in position, final positioning of the IOL was done such that one of the haptic is still supporting the area of dehiscence. In the end, all the capsular hooks were removed and the side port and main ports were sealed with hydration, making sure the anterior chamber is very well formed. In the post-op period, patient did very well with the vision improving to 6/6 with only 0.5 dark per cylinder. Thank you. Next slide, please. Next slide. So this is a post-op slit lamp photography. Thank you. Thank you all.
Thank you very much, Dr. Gopinath. That was a wonderful video. Now, I have a question or two for my expert panel to answer this. I see that a CTR, of course, we could delay as late as we can. But I'm sure the CTR should have been placed immediately after phaco rather than after the IUL being implanted was one thing I wondered. And I felt if you want to use a tricot, it should be done even before you start your phaco. You need to know the vitreous presence there when you need to do a vitrectomy first or what, and then go on with the case instead of using it again right at the end. These were two valid points. I wanted more for the audience to understand clearly at which time to do what. Yes, Ms. Dr. Kamal.
Sir, you're muted. Please unmute.
Actually feel that what you're saying is right. Putting the CTR can be delayed, but not as delayed as putting the lens, because once you have taken off care of everything inside the bag has a tendency to collapse on its own. And then the chances of you having an extension of the zonular breakdown, vitreous probably wanting to creep in into the anterior chamber, breaking of the anterior vitreous, and a lot of times you can have a knuckle of a vitreous which comes from side. So I think an ideal, as long as you can delay it, would be maybe when you have a cortical plate or maybe some part of cortex remaining. But once you clean the whole bag, then putting the lens and then putting the CTR ring is a bit tricky, I guess so. And again, I think putting the hydrocortisone, again, when you're wanting to know the extent of, is there any vitreous there in the anterior chamber, probably has to be done somewhere in the earlier part of the surgery. So I agree with you.
Anika, you want to add something?
Yeah, ma'am. I had a comment. Excellent video, Dr. Gopinathan, sir. One thing I wanted to ask you, like you put the CTR after you put in the lens and then you wanted to dial the lens again just to see that one of the haptics was around the area of the dehiscence. Yes. Sometimes the haptic could get entrapped, you know, because of the CTR. So you may not be, it may not be so easy to again dial the lens. So if you are put in the CTR, maybe before or after the cortical aspiration, before putting in the lens and also done a vitrectomy, maybe then dialing of the lens could have been a little easier. Even though it was already in place, it didn't really matter so much and the dialysis was not too severe. So you could have easily managed it. There was not so much of phacodonesis either.
Yes,
so it was a quite a stable lens that way. Yes,
Dr. Vavikar, sure. Anything to tell, doctor? Yes, Dr. Vavikar.
I would start with triamcinolone first. And I would use Viscote once the vitrectomy is done, which acts as a tamponade for the new vitreous to fresh vitreous to prolapse. And before removing the cortex from the dialysis side, I would put a CTR because while removing the cortex, sometimes you tend to increase the dialysis.
Yes, very valid points. Anything, Dr. Amurthy, or shall we go on to the next case? Excellent video, Dr. Gopinath.
Video beautifully showed the importance of using triamcinolone acetate. You know, all the steps seem to be going on quite well, but only when we put in triamcinolone, he realized the amount of vitreous which had prolapsed in. So, as was emphasized by all the others, I think that should have been the first step, and we should have done a good anterior vitrectomy first before proceeding with the rest. But obviously, good results justify the means that have been adopted.
Thank you.